Welcome to Losing a Child, Always Andy's Mom. On this podcast, we journey through the devastating experience of the death of a child. Grief is seldom discussed openly in our culture, and the death of a child makes people feel even more uncomfortable. We approach the topic openly and honestly, speaking to people who have lost loved ones and experts who help care for them. Whether you are a parent experiencing loss or someone who wants to support another going through this tragedy, this podcast strives to offer hope and help.
Welcome to episode 206 of Losing a Child, Always Andy's Mom. I'm Marcy Larson, Andy's mom. Today, I have the privilege to speak with Aga. Aga is Maximilian's mom, or as she likes to call him, Maxtraordinary Max. Max was born with hypoplastic left heart syndrome, so he had medical complications from birth, but that really didn't hold him back. He was a happy kid. He enjoyed life. He loved life, even though he couldn't run as much as the other kids. It really didn't hold him back too much. Aga is still relatively early in her grief journey, less than 2 years now. But she wanted to share her Max, her Maxtraordinary Max, with the whole world. Because that's what we want, don't we? We want our children remembered. I just love talking to her today, hearing her perspective, remembering what that time was like. And I know you will appreciate all that she has to say. So right now, I just want you to sit back and listen to Aga, Maximilian's mom. Thank you so much, Aga, for coming on the Always Andy's Mom podcast today. I'm really looking forward to talking to you today.
Thank you for your invitation, and it's an honor to be with you. I've been listening to your podcast, and I think it's brilliant. You're doing amazing.
Oh, well, thank you so much. And this is another international guest that we have on today. So we are being joined from the UK, but you are not originally from the UK.
No, I am not. I was born in Poland. Mm-hmm. I came to England in 2008, 15 years ago, and I've been living since.
Yes.
I'm not going to come back so far.
Because you were telling me what your actual given name is, and I'm not going to be able to pronounce it, so you need to say it out loud.
Yes, Agnieszka.
Agnieszka.
I think Polish people, they know. Yes, it's a very, very common Polish name.
But not so easy on the English tongue to be able to get
out.
So now you've changed it. So now you've changed
yes.
it to simplify it for all of us who don't know Polish.
Yes.
So,
yes.
But I just want you to start out by talking about your amazing son, Maximilian.
Oh, yes. Max is my third child.
Your third, yeah.
I always say is, not was, never.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He was born 24th of June, 2009. He was born with hypoplastic left heart syndrome. It means left side of his heart has never developed. Mm-hmm. I knew it about his problem when I was pregnant. And I had three options. Termination. Mm-hmm. Max would be born and will let him go naturally because without surgeries, he would not survive, or give for 3 stages of surgeries.
Right.
And they said we are giving him a 50% chance to survive. Mm-hmm. And first my thoughts were, okay, you know what? They gave me 2 weeks. And it was the time when I didn't speak English very well, but it doesn't mean I didn't understand. I understood more. And, you know, it doesn't matter if you speak native language or no. Some names, body language can tell everything. And I think they were a little bit, not pushing me, but they were very, very keen go to for termination, if I
really?
Can say.
Wow.
Yes, I felt like because it's costless.
Yeah, right.
You know, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, like, you know, it's a long, long way, long.
It is.
It's a lifetime problem.
Yeah.
But after 2 weeks, I decided I'm not God. I will fight for him.
Yeah.
I started reading. Even I sent email to America to doctor. He specialized, I don't know how it's called. They do surgeries on fetus still in mom.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Mom.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They can stretch still one of a chamber, and then heart started pumping blood, and it's not severe, let's say. But unfortunately for Max, it was too late.
Okay.
And yes, and he was born 24th of June.
How many weeks was he when he was born?
Natural 38.
38. Okay, so pretty term, yeah.
Yes. He looks like a normal, healthy baby. He didn't have any problem with breathing. He could not recognize that he was so poorly.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah, I suppose right away you can't, yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. He didn't need any oxygen. He was really healthy baby, except heart.
Yes.
And after 3 days, he was transported to different hospital. He was born Wednesday evening, and he was transported Friday. And then immediately on Saturday in the morning, I signed papers that he's going to have his first surgery.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the reason they can look so good at the beginning, so we're going to talk a little bit medical. I'm going to back up just to kind of educate people, because I have taken care of a lot of kids with this. So, you know, you have two pumping chambers of the heart, your right ventricle and left ventricle, and the left ventricle pumps to the body and the right ventricle pumps to the lungs primarily. And in utero, in the uterus, obviously, you don't need blood to pump to the lungs because the lungs don't, I mean, not much, because the lungs aren't functioning in that way. You get all your oxygen just from mom. So because of that, they have a nice little shunt that things, the blood can easily go from the area that's supposed to go to the lungs out to the body. Okay. And they've got this little thing. And so when you're born, you still have that. And over the first couple of days, that will shrink down. And so then it will separate those two systems. So then you have the left ventricle going to the body, the right ventricle going to the lungs. And those are completely separate systems then. But it takes a couple of days to transition that. So sometimes the babies, even when they're born like that, it's okay because you've got that. Well, that's why, though, right away, you need to intervene to keep that open. That little shunt needs to stay there and
yes.
not close off to nothing. So that's why you can look great for a little bit, and why it's so important to diagnose it prenatally so you can be ready to do something really pretty soon afterwards. So I'm sure they did that, and they did that procedure to keep things open and mixing.
Yes, and I think he was a very strong boy.
Yeah.
He wanted to fight because we left hospital after 2 weeks.
Wow.
Yes, some kids, they stay till next surgery.
Yes.
4 months, 6 months, like you know. Max was strong. Max on intensive care maybe 5 days, 6 days. Then I started breastfeeding him.
Really?
Yes, and it was not a problem at all.
Yeah.
Yes, we had many problems, of course. Every infection was scary. Then when he was 4.5 months old, we had second surgery.
Mm-hmm.
And everything was fine. We were 5 days.
Okay.
In hospital, or six. Between, we had many cardiac catheters to check if his heart is healthy. But generally, he was, let's say, yes, at the beginning, you could see he was behind.
Yeah,
he was
sure.
behind with his motor skills. He was behind with his speech. But let's say if I compare him when he was 12 years old boy, he was just normal, healthy boy.
Yeah. Wow.
And, you know, sometimes when you've got child with medical needs, unfortunately, I don't want to say sacrifice because it's very, very horrible words. It means moms, we don't sacrifice life. We will do it willingly. Yes.
Of course. Yeah.
Because unconditional love. But because of his medical condition, I have to stop working.
Yeah.
I have to, you know, friendship, relationship, everything I think was falling apart.
Mm-hmm.
Because I needed focus on his needs, his development and everything. And I didn't work for nearly 6 years.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's expected, really, because that's what your job is to be that primary caregiver
Yeah, absolutely.
When you have a kid that's medically fragile like that. Mm-hmm.
Yes, but there is a conflict inside you, yes?
Yeah.
When you are, let's say, educated woman, you want to be independent, especially my relationship was not great. I became dependent on my ex-partner, ex-husband. And unfortunately, it didn't go right way in the end. And I finished on my own with 3 kids, one with medical needs, without money, on my own. And it was really, really hard.
Yeah.
Despite everything that I think you have to change your priorities, yes? And then when you change it, you have peace with yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, you are now only a mom and your love is everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is why at the end, when you, let's say you, when your child passed away, you cannot really you can't really get over it because you think like 12 years of your work.
Yeah, for sure.
Just, I don't want to say wasted because it's really bad word, but it's,
it wasn't wasted. Yeah,
absolutely. It's like you feel why it's happened, why as a single mom with 3 kids doing everything what I could, why I cannot be rewarded.
Yeah
And my son can be in this 60% people who are part of them, they are doing brilliant, they are doing great, they have normal lives, kids.
Yeah,
maybe not normal, but they still need to extra care.
Pretty normal, yeah.
But they can have normal life, but not Max.
Yeah.
And then Max.
Well, and I think you're talking too about that, you know, that's been your purpose really, and your role was to care for him, that you were his caregiver. And it's very difficult after you've done that for so many years to try to kind of know what your life is going to be now moving forward.
Yes. It's
so, so different.
Absolutely.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Max's personality because I want to hear about
it. Yeah, absolutely. Because I was going to different way, more his medical stuff. Max was just amazing child. Like,
yeah.
I think sorry.
No, it's okay.
You know, we are all getting emotional.
Yes.
We want to talk about our kids, but then we know it's very painful.
Yes. Yes.
We wanted everybody know about it, but about kids.
Yeah.
We talk about our children, but then in the end, it's unfortunately a very painful journey. Max was just amazing. Just, I think, like, every parent, every mom could imagine your child.
Yeah.
Caring, funny, never judgmental, very social. He wanted to try everything. As a young boy, he already knew it, what he wanted to do in his life.
Really? What did he want to do?
He wanted to be cardiologist.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And because he always kept saying, if my doctor helped me, I would help different people because I understand them more.
Yeah.
That they understand me. Mm-hmm. What was true, because I will know what they feel because I've been through it as well.
Right. Right.
And I could describe him as a young boy with very old soul.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, some of the kids, they are just born to bring light.
Yeah.
Some of people generally bring light, bring happiness. Even if I was a little bit, judge his friends because they misbehave at home or they were too often at home. Why they don't invite you? Why you always bring them here? He always tried to explain them. He never judged them. And I think I learned from him so many things.
Yeah.
Patient, love, happiness. He was able to see beauty in every person.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then you realize, yeah, absolutely. And then you are angry with, I don't know, whoever you believe in, God, yeah, universe, energies, you are angry. Why you have taken so beautiful soul?
Yeah.
He could have brought so many good things here, but he was not able.
So I want you to talk about your t-shirt that you're wearing, because you're wearing a t-shirt that says Maxtraordinary.
Yes. yes, because I think Max was special. Like I said, he accepted himself with all his illness. He knew it, he couldn't run. He knew it, he can't be footballer. But even when I've got from his school, why you are proud of yourself? What did you do in life? Something like, I am special because I've got half heart and I am proud of it.
I love that. I love that he said that.
I think I taught him to be proud of it. I always said, you are like Iron Man. You've got special heart. It doesn't matter, kids. They laugh at you because you cannot run. You are special in different way. What they cannot be, just think about it. And he felt like, I'm special because I've got half a heart. You cannot have what you've got.
Yeah.
And you can run, but you can't have a half heart. And this is, like I said, he saw beauty in everything. He never stepped on ants. He could pick up every creature from the floor to save it. It's just like a beautiful soul. And I decided to keep his memory alive with my friends, because my friends helped me a lot. That I have to organize something to keep his memory alive. Like, you know, we mothers will remember our children forever. But people move on, what is very, very normal, natural. They will remember occasionally, but somehow they move on. We never move on.
No.
This is why Max went to secondary school. I'm not sure, probably in America it's high school.
Okay.
I don't know. Yes, it was between 10 and 12.
Okay, so probably middle school or junior high is what we call that here.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Yes. And I just decided that a school had 1,500 students, six houses.
Wow.
It means I decided to reward one child from one house. And this is his t-shirt. I can show you. It's a special design, M with wings.
Yes.
And a star, because he was a star, plus he loves Marvel.
Yes.
Oh, Iron Man, Spider-Man, like, you know, like all boys, they love it. This is why it's a little bit like funky Spider-Man.
I love that you did that comparison to Iron Man. That's awesome.
Yes. Max is from Max. And Maxtra, because it's extraordinary.
Right.
It means you can be Maxtraordinary person.
Yes. Love that.
And I decided to reward, like I said, six children. From one house for something what people don't appreciate, but they are doing amazing job work.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's me. Example, I don't know, someone looks after mom because mom is ill.
Yeah.
And do they see the child struggle? No.
Right. Right.
Because it's just a child. Yes. We always rewarded people, like, I don't know, really good at math, English, or very disabled children, because this is what we do. We want to help families. We want to help everybody around. But kids in the middle, they are like forgotten children.
Yeah.
Like sometimes you've got problem with second child, It's like, I always keep saying it's a little bit like forgotten child. You know? And this is why I decided to reward it. Extraordinary people who they've done something what it's brilliant, amazing, and they will get t-shirt, trophy, and a voucher. And I hope I can keep doing it. I don't know, I would love to do it every year. And then maybe spread reward around different school. Of course, you know, it's very difficult when you work full time, when you're still single mom, when you try to pay your bills and everything. It's very difficult to do it on your own.
Right.
And you're a grieving mother as well.
Well, why don't we step back a bit and talk about Max? Because he was doing really well medically, right? You said he was doing fantastic. I mean, the surgeries went pretty easy as far as the surgeries go. And he was doing well.
Yes. It means when he had third surgery in 2013, this is the last one, the last surgery closed all stages of, I don't want to say reconstruction, because people, they think it's reconstruction.
It's not really,
No. It's something what keep them alive, let's say.
Right.
His oxygen was still low. It means 82%, what for our normal people will be probably in the hospital, but his body got used to it.
Yep, you get so used to it.
He developed protein-losing enteropathy in 2013.
Okay.
It means he was losing albumins.
Yeah.
But it's a little bit complicated. I don't want to get into details because we'll spend probably 5 hours. It means they try to do something. And when you got third surgery, you've got fenestration.
Mm-hmm. And that fenestration is like little holes. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Here, it's a tube. Yeah. And the hole was closed.
Okay.
They decided to open.
Right.
Totally. And for example, after his first surgery, his oxygen was 95 and he was running. He was very, very hyper because suddenly he could enjoy it. Yes.
Right.
Oh, wow. I can run without being breathless. But unfortunately, they had to do something and open fenestration and his oxygen dropped down.
Yeah.
But we didn't have problem with proteins. And let's say we were living happy life between 2013 and 2019.
Yeah.
Let's say, yes, I knew it, Max has hypoplastic left syndrome, but we traveled to different countries. He had friends. He was riding bike. Yes, he had limitation, but let's say normal life. And you can see his photos. He looks like a normal, healthy boy. Skinny, smaller, but healthy. And unfortunately, in 2019, against a little bit my will, doctors, they decided to close his fenestration again.
Right, to try to get him a little more energy. And
Yes, because they wanted to improve his stamina.
Yes.
I asked them many, many times, are you sure if we close it, protein-losing enteropathy would not come back? And they said, oh, based on all, you know, details, I'm sure 100%.
Yeah.
Not really. You know, when you as a mother, you always have this kind of intuition.
Yeah.
Don't go somewhere. Don't do something.
I know.
Because, you know, and then you blame yourself. Why I didn't stop it?
Well, yeah. I mean,
you can understand me.
I mean, it's easy for me to tell you not to, but it's...
Yes.
And you know that you shouldn't. It's one of those things that you know intellectually. You didn't really have a reason to say, don't do it. They would have thought you were making a horrible decision, right?
No, but you know, I knew it as a mom. It was the wrong decision. And as a mom, they didn't give me a chance to make decision.
Yeah.
It means, okay, we improve his stamina. He will have oxygen 95, but it's a risky. Protein-losing enteropathy can come back. Or he can live with 82% oxygen, but he cannot run.
Yeah.
And I will go for a second option, but they didn't give me. They were overconfident.
Yeah.
And I am getting angry at, and I'm talking about it, because in England, they still cannot deal with protein-losing enteropathy.
Mm-hmm.
I know in America, because I try as well, you know, medicine is more advanced. They can do many different kind of things, and heart transplant is easier than here.
Right.
And despite everything, they took a risk. And everything from cardiac catheter, everything started really, really badly. It means they tried to reverse what they did. It didn't work. They put him on steroids. Max hated.
Yeah.
You can imagine being on steroids. It means his feature changed. He had this Cushing syndrome.
So he gets all puffy and
absolutely lump on the back, and he hates himself.
Yeah.
He really hates himself. And despite it, he was very confident. He always looked at himself. Yes, I am fat.
Mm-hmm.
Still could kid, and he was wearing 80s glasses. He had long hair, and he was, yes, obese, if I can say. He put on weight 2 stones during few months.
I'm sure just because of all that steroid, it can just do all of that to you.
Absolutely. And despite they were doing everything to reverse it, they couldn't. And they decided to transplant.
Okay.
No, not transplant. They refer him to heart transplant team.
Yeah.
It was COVID. Unfortunately, like you know, COVID didn't help.
No.
And during the COVID, they did heart transplant assessment with different hospital via Zoom.
Mm-hmm.
My anger is getting bigger.
Right.
Because how can you assess someone via Zoom? Why you did it with Max, but another children, they have chance?
Mm-hmm.
It means why you didn't see us face to face.
Yeah.
I'm sure many moms, they have the same problems when you've got child with medical needs.
Mm.
And then life was going for 3 years up and down all the time. Medication, yes, albumins, they were up. Then Max struggled with osteoporosis because of steroids. But he still was, let's say, happy boy, if I can say. Happy, still bubbly, still funny. He's got really, really, he knew it when he can say something just right, like a sarcastic nature, but in a really funny way.
Yeah.
I tell you a story, for example, when he was really, really small, Batman, I allowed him to watch Warren C with Brad Pitt.
Okay.
And yeah, he loved it. He loved all zombies. I don't know. He was maybe 7 years old because he was watching with his brother. And we went to do x-ray. And we were waiting in like a waiting room. And one woman, she walked past by. Like you could see she was maybe after stroke.
Okay.
And very loudly, he pointed at her, Mom, look, zombie from World Z.
Oh, my. Oh, dear. And you're like, oh, I'm so sorry.
Because she was walking like, yes. Oh, zombie. Yes. And despite everything, they couldn't find solution for him to stop losing albumins.
Yeah.
And then they opened totally fenestration in 2021. Yes. Sometimes I'm losing, you know, sometimes you don't remember. In 2021, they opened his fenestration totally and they stopped steroids because they have side effects was horrendous.
Yeah.
Really. He really struggled. One day he said to me when blood test every 1 week, 2 weeks, he didn't want any magic cream. He was really, really brave. And he said to me one day in the car, Mom, do you think when I go to heaven, I will be still in pain?
Oh.
I said, why are you talking like that?
Oh.
And I said, no, I don't know, Max. I said, don't talk like that. And he said, if I don't feel any pain, I wanted to go.
Oh, that's just heartbreaking for a mom, isn't it?
Yes. And I think we were having more and more conversation like that. One day he even asked me, Mom, I'm going to die. And I think part of me, I knew it can finish badly, but I always try to have hope, like, no.
Right.
Max was strong enough.
Right, right.
That there's no way he can die. There's no way.
Right.
And the long story short, Max contracted influenza A.
Yeah.
And of course, with illness, with flu, he started to have, unfortunately, very bad diarrhea.
Yeah.
20 times, 40 times per day, literally. And he started losing weight. And albumins, they dropped down. And we were admitted to hospital. And of course, like Max, picked up. He was fine. But they asked me to be prepared for everything. They involve palliative care.
Yeah.
And hospice, but you still don't think, not my son, no.
Right.
And then we came back home, we bought a cart, Max asked for a cart, we bought a cart. And again, many medical things happened that I even don't want to talk about it because I'm getting angry. And then I could blame doctors. I could blame many people. Mm-hmm. The deal was we are coming back to home because it was good for Max's mental health. But he will have infusion from albumins every 2-3 days. But he didn't have it for 1 week. And he deteriorated very, very quickly. We were admitted again to hospital. Suddenly they came up from ideas. Okay, again, heart transplant team, and we will do something different. We'll have a meeting with bigger team about doing, you know, with bowel, with protein cleansing enteropathy, you've got holes in your bowel or holes in your lymphatic system. And they tried to do something with it. Everything, let's say, was prepared. We were waiting for transport to the another hospital to heart transplant team. 9 days, and transport never came. Max was complaining the day before that one leg feels funny. But, you know, legs. Yes, he had osteoporosis, let's say, and everything can happen. But during the night, we couldn't move him. He was screaming. Three of us, we had to take him to toilet. My first thought was, okay, it's broken. It's broken because osteoporosis, because of medication. I don't know, somehow, I don't know. And in the morning, his blood pressure dropped. His heartbeat was 170. Suddenly, I could hear only code blue. Around his bed was all ICU team, intensive care team. Very quickly, they took him it was 10 o'clock. They took him to intensive care. They sedated him a little bit to put central line, to pump as much as they can medication for blood pressure to make it higher. And unfortunately, Max died 6 o'clock.
Wow. Wow. It's one of those things that when you tell it in a long story, it feels like it, you know, and obviously we all know the end, right? We all know that Max was going to die. And so you kind of see it coming. But when you're living it, I don't think you do see it coming.
No.
I think you just live from one thing to another, and he just always makes it through. And you think, okay, so maybe he broke his leg or what, you know, you think you've got another obstacle in front of you, but I don't think you think it's the last one.
No, especially when we had a really nice evening Saturday. We had pizza. We were talking about heart transplant. He said, oh, mom, can I send a letter to the people who will give me a heart? Because I knew it, someone has to die. And I said, of course. Yeah. You know, we were talking about it. But everything was fine. Everything was fine. Yeah. And I knew it might come, but I didn't know it would be like, we don't know generally.
And I don't think you want to let your head get there. You don't want to even think about it. Well, you can't. I mean, that's the thing. You can't. To every mom I've talked to, no matter how you lose your child, if you lose your child after a long illness and it's really expected, say cancer, and you knew weeks and weeks and months ahead that they were dying, or you lose your son like me in a car accident. In some ways, it doesn't matter because you can't really know what it will feel like after they're gone.
No, absolutely.
I mean, you think you can prepare yourself, but you can't.
No, never.
You can't. It's just so unbelievable to even live in a world where your child isn't.
No, you know, and every grieving mothers, we know you will never be prepared. It doesn't matter how ill your child is or how died, you are never prepared. And seeing, you know I listen to your podcast about your story. You know, when you see all lines, all people trying to save your child's life.
Yeah.
It stays with you all your life.
Yeah.
And you always asking, why? You're always asking, maybe if I have done something different, he would have lived. Yeah, and we still don't know.
Yeah, I think we all do that.
Yes, we still don't know cause of his death. Of course, it's heart failure, but why?
Yeah.
Some few people can think it was sepsis. It's look like. Mm-hmm. Some of people, they said maybe he had a clot.
Yeah.
We don't know.
I wondered about that myself. With that much pain, you'd think maybe he had a clot in his leg, but
Yes, and all together, because his body was just tired.
Yes.
You see everything. You see every medical team trying to save his life, and then suddenly everything stopped.
Yeah.
And it's this kind of silence when they ask you to be with your son, when they ask you to wash his body, and you do it, everything like a robot. I couldn't I even couldn't talk to him, and I blame myself now. Why, when he was on intensive care, I couldn't talk to him, because I don't even remember why my ex-husband was there. I called him to come, because Max is dying, was dying.
Right.
And he saw Max 1 week before, only 40 minutes. And we were laughing with Max. Oh, how long your dad will stay with you? 30 minutes, 40. And we were, it's like, oh, if 40, I will buy something, because this is your time.
That's a record or something.
Yeah, exactly. And he came, and we didn't even talk to each other. We were like stranger. He had no idea what is going on. He had no idea about his medical issues, nothing. And my kids, older kids, I've got 22 years old daughter and 18 years old son. They came. I asked them to come with my really good friends, but they were too late.
Yeah.
They were too late. Max was gone. And I think you live with pictures, with this trauma, the last minutes, all your life. I always had, like, say, my wish with, I wanted to deal with God. If you want to take him during the dream, or take him during surgery. But he was taken really unexpectedly.
Yeah, right.
What I cannot deal with it.
Right.
And I think my world totally collapsed, because, let's say, my life is connected with my children. As a single mom, I've been single mom since I remember.
Yeah,
up and down, but since I remember, it means I've been raising my children on my own. And suddenly, especially with child with medical condition, when you know you have to give them medication, you have medical appointments, you just live for it. You just, you're used to it. And it's normal life. And suddenly one day is silence, nothing. You're coming back home.
Yes.
There is no, you are not needed.
Right.
Because older children, yes. My daughter, she just finished university. She doesn't live at home. Older son, he is with friends. And suddenly you don't have a purpose.
Yes.
You don't have a purpose. And literally everything is taken away. Your identity. Mm-hmm. Everything what you have built for 12 years, it's not here anymore. And you have to rebuild your world.
Yes.
And you don't know how.
Right. Right.
Nobody is going to help you. Nobody is going to tell you how. You have to just do it. You have to keep going, because you've got only one choice, two choices, yes?
Right.
You keep going. Maybe three, I could say. You've got three choices, in my opinion. Everybody can have different opinion. You just decided to, you are going with your child, what is very, we all have thoughts like that, yes? Especially at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You wanted still protect your child no matter what. This is why you want to be with them. Mm-hmm. Then you are giving up and you are very depressed. Or you try to live no matter what and enjoy life.
Yes.
I'm still in the middle, in both worlds.
Trying. Right.
Because it's only 16 months since Max passed away. But it's very, very difficult. You push yourself to do something. And after when Max passed away, I came back to my work immediately. which was crazy because I didn't have time to grieve.
Yeah.
You know, you keep yourself busy, 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 busy all the time. And then you've got this kind of...
And it feels like that's the smart choice.
No, but absolutely no. No, you have to grieve. You have to have time when you are the most miserable person on the planet. Mm-hmm. Because you are. When grief hits you, you cannot breathe.
Yeah.
And it makes you physically tired, sick, and everything.
Right. And you just don't want to feel that way. So you think, I'll just stay busy so I don't feel that way. But you have to.
Yeah.
You have to.
Yeah. I hate it.
Because it won't. If you just push it away for a while, that's all you can do. And it will still come up and grab you.
Absolutely. And but I like I said, I've been working since Max passed away. Over time, I had only 2 weeks off when before his anniversary. But unfortunately, grief is very unpredictable. It hits you everywhere. You go to shop, you cry. Someone asks you about your how many kids you've got, you cry. You want to celebrate. Some people are against it. Some of people, they are happy to do it with you. And it's very, very difficult journey. I think the hardest journey on the planet.
Yes.
I think nobody can imagine. Only I think grieving mother can understand another mother.
Yes. Yes. Because you can't imagine it, no matter how much you try. Your story reminds me very much of my dear friend Stephanie, who is, of course, on one of the very, very early episodes with me, because she lost her daughter at 12 and she... It was a long kind of illness. And she even went to therapy to prepare herself for Kian's death. And she wasn't prepared. She wasn't prepared. No. She did all of this and she wasn't prepared. And she talks so much about her purpose and her support system. And, you know, going from medical appointment to a medical appointment to medical appointment. I mean, all of those staff, those hospital staff, they become like your support, almost your friends.
And absolutely,
then your child dies, they're gone.
Yes.
And it's not like they're, I mean, it's not their fault that they're gone. There's no reason for you to now see them. And they may send a very nice card and all sorts of things. But I mean, you just feel really alone.
Yeah, especially when, I don't know, if you've got a partner or family around. I don't have family around. My family, they are my friends.
Right.
And they help me a lot. I think without them, I am not sure I'll be here. I will be so, you know, it's just they are amazing. But suddenly it's even not about that you don't do this all medical stuff. Suddenly, even in financial way, I'm not sure about system in America, but in England, when you've got disabled child, you've got support from government. And part of you, you feel secured. Especially as a single mm-hmm. person, single mom, you feel secure that no matter what, if you work or not, you'll survive. Mm-hmm. And suddenly this kind of financial security is taken away in few weeks and nobody asks you.
Which is so crazy, right? Because you're in way worse shape now than you were.
Absolutely. And then you can only imagine, okay, I was lucky enough that I had a job. And I could come back, but there's many mothers, they looking after child with medical condition, they couldn't, you know, do any jobs, they couldn't go to school because priority was a child, and suddenly everything is taken away and nobody really cares mm-hmm. if you survive or no, if you can pay your bills. What is really, really crazy, you've got only 2 weeks for let's say grieving process. Okay, you can take longer, but generally according to government. And then during 6 weeks or 8 weeks, everything is taken away. And how you're going to, as a grieving mother, find a new job, new purpose, new life, it's impossible.
That is impossible.
It's impossible. Some of mothers, they struggle all life. They will never be the same. We'll never be the same, let's be honest.
No. But none of us will, but yeah.
But you know, somehow you have to find a purpose.
Yes.
It's just this kind of emptiness. And part of you, you've got freedom with, you know, in my case, Yes, because I don't have this all medical stuff. You know, living with child with medical condition like Max, it's living with massive anxiety.
Yes.
Because every holidays, we have to have extra insurance. Every holidays, if something happened day before, we can't go. If something happened, it's his illness was unpredictable. And you live with higher level of adrenaline or cortisol all the time.
All the time. Mm-hmm.
All your life. Yeah. Because, and this is your life. You're just used to it. You love it. Yes, let's say. You hate it, but you love it. And then suddenly, it's gone.
Yeah.
It's literally gone. You don't have it.
Yeah.
You don't have it. And you've got freedom. I can, let's say I could travel, yes, around the world if I could. I could do many different things. But I hate it. I hate that I can enjoy life.
Yes. I'm sure.
I hate it.
I'm sure you do.
I hate this kind of free time when I can come back home, put my feet on the table and say, okay, I cannot do it because I've got a lot of work to do, but I can't do it. I don't need
to. You could sit down and watch a movie or something,
absolutely. And I don't need to worry if I have call from school because Max has migraine, Max doesn't feel very well. And I hate it because I miss it so much.
Yeah.
I miss this kind of responsibility when I was needed.
Mm-hmm.
He needed me. And I think me and him, we were so close. It's like nearly soulmate.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We literally fought the same. And it's just, he was mini me.
Yeah.
And this is why it's so difficult to live.
To live without him.
Yes. To see bright future, to see the sun. Unfortunately, when you get older, you are getting more tired, you don't bother. And then when you don't have purpose, you're asking yourself, okay, how long? How long I can be miserable?
Yeah.
What is my purpose now? And yeah, it just you put mask on your face at you know, like probably do it as well.
Oh yeah, I do.
If you ask my colleagues from work, they will never probably said, "Oh, our guy's miserable."
No,
I'm always happy, bubbly, smiley, but then I'm coming back home and I crash.
Yeah,
crash in the evening, in the morning. But very rare in front of people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because I know this is my journey.
Yeah.
This is my journey.
And you keep the mask on. You keep the mask on.
Absolutely. This is my journey and my children's journey as well. Because they struggle. They struggle in different way. I'm not sure about your children, but my daughter, she prefer. Yes, we talk about Max, but she doesn't want to do many things connected with Max because she struggled. But my older son, when Max passed away, he had to be medicated because he couldn't function because they were like best buddies, watch the same movies, play the same games, you know, like two nearly teenagers because Max was 12, Victor was 17. But now Max doesn't exist for him.
Right.
He doesn't want to talk about him. Nothing. If he sees me upset,
it's just too painful.
He just avoid me. He cannot just cope. And I know I'm worried because one day grief will come.
Yeah.
Like a tsunami.
Yes. You're right. Because he's a teenager and he just doesn't want to show that emotion. Yes. And he just feels like if he just pushes it away, it'll just go away.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And grieving journey is very difficult journey. I've got therapy as well. I've been doing therapy since Max passed away. Counseling.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, I try because I had such a bad post-traumatic syndrome disorder. Everything what's happened during the, you know, last hours of Max's life. They decided to do EMDR therapy, eye movement.
I wondered if you were doing that. I do that.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I think it's helped.
Yes. I think it, I hate doing it, but I think it really does help.
I hate it. I'll be honest. Mm-hmm. It's the most traumatic therapy I have ever had in my life. Because you have to go very, very deep.
I totally know. It's so funny because when I go to therapy, I always think to myself, am I going to have to do EMDR today? I really don't want to do EMDR today. And I feel like if I want to try to talk about other things enough, then maybe we won't have enough time for EMDR, even though I know it really helps me. It has helped me.
Yes, I was exactly the same. A few times I said, can we do happy therapy today? Music therapy, art therapy, and I did as well. I had part of art therapy.
Yes, and I don't, and she doesn't do it every time. I just can't do it every time. No. But it has gotten me to the point where I can drive past the accident site and not, you know, have to pull off the side of the road and because I'm throwing up. I mean, that's what it used to be like.
Yes.
So it's helped a lot. I still need to do more work, and it's been almost 5 years and I still need to do more work because I stopped for a while because I hated it so much.
Yes.
But it turns out it really is helpful.
Yeah, I stopped my last session this week and I said I don't want to do it anymore.
Yeah.
It's before every session, I literally physically, I was sick.
Yeah.
It's like massive, massive anxiety, sickness, because I knew it, I have to talk about something what is very painful.
Right. And I think maybe sometime you will be able to do that again. But
yes, maybe.
For me, I needed a break. I just needed a break.
Yes, in me as well.
And it sounds like you need a break now, is you just need a break. And if at some point in time, you know, you need to go back and do it again, it, you know, my therapist always calls it kind of like layers of an onion. Like you just do kind of layers at a time.
Yes.
To just get rid of some of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Pain that you will be able to function better. So, but you just can't do it. Just keep going at it, plugging at it. It's really hard.
For me, for example, at the beginning, if I had to go to hospitals for my blood test, for, I don't know, just normal things. Every time it was me for a trauma, smell,
right.
Seeing doctors, just like there were little triggers. And but these little triggers, it was open wounds, open many, many dark doors. I always keep saying, I try to compare grief and grieving process like you are in the middle of a dark forest and you've got this kind of hope that you will see light. And sometimes you see light, you're going towards and then light disappeared again and again and again. And it's sometimes it's darker, sometimes it's getting brighter, lighter, but you're still in the middle of a forest.
Right. Yeah. I love that analogy. That's perfect. It really does feel perfect.
And it's just there's everything can, when you touch tree, there are triggers, yes?
Yeah.
And they can be with you all your life. Because there was always, I'm not sure about you, but I leave, usually with kids, you leave Christmas,
Seeing
normal family, let's say, date in calendar. I leave now what I feel guilty about it. I leave Max's death, Max's funeral, and Max's birthday.
Yeah.
And now will be Max's reward. And again, this is my year now. Not Christmas, because, you know, Christmas is horrendous. Christmas is... I hate Christmas. I always hate Christmas, but now even more.
Yeah.
How are you going to survive Christmas, first Christmas? Yes, we survived first Christmas. We didn't stay at home at all.
No.
We couldn't because Max was always very excited about Christmas presents. And we had very Polish tradition as well. We bake cookies, different kind of dishes. And I couldn't do it. I just couldn't. Yeah. We just decided to go away to totally different country when they don't celebrate Christmas, and it was less painful. Still painful, but less painful.
We flew to Las Vegas.
Oh, nice. I've never been to America. Maybe one day.
Anyway, Las Vegas is a crazy place to be at Christmas and doesn't really feel like Christmas in the middle of the desert. It was perfect.
Oh, good to know.
Actually, it was perfect, and I spent time with my aunt. So, yes.
Yes.
People thought it was crazy that we were flying on Christmas Eve. We're flying to Las Vegas, but it worked out.
Yes, because you don't want to celebrate. But then if you've got younger children, you have to do it for them. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't have younger children because...
Yeah, we did. We did. And we had some people that actually bought us Christmas presents because I just couldn't do it. And so this is very nice. I don't even know who did it. Somebody.
Oh, nice.
Just bought us my kids Christmas presents. Yeah.
Yes.
I still don't know to this day, 5 years later.
Now, I make a deal with my children. Okay, we are going somewhere, or do you want a present and stay at home? We decided to go abroad. And but this year, my son, he wanted to stay at home.
Okay. Yeah, and it can be different every year, right? It can be different every year.
Yes, absolutely. But it's Christmas, birthdays, they always trigger more. And it's like journey will end with me. And, you know, it's just life journey. It will never end.
And you're right. You kind of just count. Right now, I'm on a countdown because a month from tomorrow is the 5 year anniversary of Andy's death. And it's like I'm counting down every day, dreading this coming, dreading the month of August coming. And it's not how I want to live, but it's just the way that it is.
Yes.
It's just the way that it is right now.
Yes, absolutely. And closer to any anniversary, doesn't matter what kind, you cannot cope physically, mentally. And then week after or two, again and again. And it's like a vicious circle. You cannot escape.
Yeah.
You have to learn how to live. And it's a difficult journey, very, very difficult journey. And nobody can understand.
No one. You're right. Unless you're living it, you can't really understand it. And I don't want people to be able to, right? Because if you understand it, it's because you've lived it.
Yeah. I love listening to stories, especially when with people who they've been grieving parents for 10, 20 years. Some of them, give you hope that might be a little bit better. You still grieve, you still cry, you still have your little breakdowns.
Right. But the pain isn't quite so sharp. And it's not for me, right? I'm 5 years in almost, and it's not as sharp as it once was. So I hope that we can give people a little bit of hope by telling stories.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And some of people, they work too much. Some of people, they use medication. No matter what you do, you have to cope with your pain. This pain, even I cannot describe, I think I cannot find words on Polish or English dictionary to describe pain.
Right. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much as well.
For sharing your extraordinary, or Maxtraordinary, Maksymilian. I loved hearing about him. And I really appreciated what all you had to say and what you've been going through. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. It was lovely. Hopefully you understood me very well with my Polish accent and sometimes twisted words.
I did. I feel like I did. That is okay. It was great. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was really lovely.
Thanks for listening. If you found this helpful or would like to support the podcast, please leave a 5-star rating and comment. To help financially, you can text Andy's Mom to the number 53555 or visit the donate page on andysmom.com. Your donations are secure and tax deductible, and we are now able to accept Venmo, PayPal, and Apple Pay. Always Andy's Mom is a registered 501c3 organization and can receive donations through smile.amazon.com, Thrivent Financial, and Benevity, amongst others. Marcy loves hearing from listeners. Please feel free to reach out to her via email at marcy@andysmom.com. Also, be sure to sign up for the email list to receive weekly updates, as well as pictures of all of Marcy's guests and their children. Together, let's work to inspire hope, one day at a time.